Across all mediums, there is an ever-changing constant to be found. It stares us in the face, making no effort to hide itself, but to allow us to indulge with reckless abandon. The catalyst that sets expectations in place, aesthetic, a tool utilized by all forms of media and art for the purpose of tone setting. In writing, it is articulated through carefully chosen words that chisel the detail from a blank stone.
The sun was blazing down from a sky which seemed to be almost black in its cloudless cruelty, as though reflecting the inky marsh beneath my feet.
Vivid details and a concise delivery. A description so detailed allows for a reader, especially one whose imagination is thoroughly active, to place themselves in such a setting with little difficulty. In visual art, it is through the selected style and texture of the piece. Each brush chosen is of equal importance to the pigments utilized in building or adding to worlds formed by the artist. Gritty and dark, the people are not as they seem. Despite the sophisticated selection of clothing, there is a primal spell cast upon them that can't be explained by normal means. A transformation takes place over the guise of rough strokes of dark tones and bright shades of whites and grays. This is not the first, nor the last. There is more than what meets the eye. Men, women, and children will not be exempt of this detestable law set in motion by the court of an alien nature. In music, it is through the structure of the soundscape, its tones, melodies, vocals, and esoteric details that may go unnoticed until further examined. And in some instances, well-designed audio can pull a listener into a universe beyond their own. Aphotic and foreboding, a symphony from another existence outside of our own. It's infectious, ear-piercing, yet oddly enjoyable. It feels almost natural, like a wind across a desolate desert. But there's something more layered within. The ever-shifting mechanisms of another universe interlaced with soft static and a tired, grumbling bass. Where the emotion is hollow, the sound is full. Although each medium has its stark contrasts, their intent remains the same. Provoke evocative patterns within the minds of patrons who indulge in the art. All three of the aforementioned mediums succeed just as well as the other, so long as the artist behind the work is capable of producing such detail. In the case of a guided experience such as a film, the effort is shared between the writing, music, and visual flair, each one retaining their value and aesthetic and amplifying each other through a symbiotic relationship. These artistic parasites feed into one another, oiling the machine and adjusting the bolts. Together, they create a new level of detail that works to magnify the existing aesthetic to a degree in which very few can go without noticing. If a touching scene had lacked the audio that made it so, would it be as moving? If a series of scenes had been reduced to a single still frame, would it portray the world as effectively? If a character lacked direction in their writing, would they be as interesting? When everything comes together, it brings clarity to those who are uncertain, either encapsulating or dissuading them from continuing down the rabbit hole. But for those who remain invested, with an open mind and careful eye, the outcome is something unrepeatable and engrossing. Mad God, a film that had taken 3 decades to finally release, has become available for online viewing. 30 years of director Phil Tippett crafting some of the finest visuals in numerous blockbuster films, such as Jurassic Park and Starship Troopers, and infrequently working on his passion project that had been set aside several times since the 90s. In 2012, a final Kickstarter campaign that would aid in funding the movie's production was met threefold. Another decade would pass before the eventual release. Aesthetic in films, as we briefly discussed, is a collaborative effort where the various mediums come together to create something unique. When left unrestricted, this creative wildfire can run rampant, leaving behind the immolated remains of something sane. When first introduced to the world of Mad God, the environment hastily divulges its secrets to us. This land is not for the stable and careless. It is a war-torn wasteland for the deranged and reckless. However, even in a wasteland, there is always someone, or something, to be found. Descending from the dark, clouded skies laden in gunsmoke from machines of war, comes a pod of steel, housing the heavily clothed assassin. His demeanor neutral, and his intent mysterious. He is as enigmatic as the world itself. The soothing melancholic guitar plays as a background for the heavy gunshots, swiveling servo motors, and wailing air raid sirens, leaving a relaxing yet tense atmosphere to set the mood. The interior of the claustrophobic pod is as depressing as the land of which the assassin is destined to reach. Pipes and valves hiss at the slightest shake of the vessel, whilst the dilapidated birdcage rattles along with the bones of the deceased companion. As the descent continues, in the background, who we will later know as slaves work and walk amongst the pipes. The wastewater that had formerly been flowing through the tubing has long since frozen, locked in time, and without closure. The world is repulsive, miserable, and a clear sign of a ruthless rule by an unseen authority. The melodies in tune accentuate as the assassin falls further below the cold surface, beyond the fortress that so clearly was meant to keep undesirable invaders from infiltrating the heart of this world. But infiltrate the assassin does, passing the fossilized sites from times long ago, forested chambers which, despite the dreary darkness that consumes them, is home to many insects and gangly flora. Dozens of colossal idols watch the exposed entrance into the unknown, their empty stone forms being the most inviting of all figures. And nearing the bottom, monolithic formations of stone tower in this subterranean world, laced in color and life. Beyond them, even further, devastation and deterioration of what we would have known as civilization is all that is left after untold years of conflict and apocalypse. Slime and filth, violence and curiosity, flesh and machine, normality and absurdity. The further the assassin wanders, the more horror-like the world becomes. However, even a mark of comedy can be found in the cruelty of this life within these dismal living spaces. This isn't to say that those involved are in on the joke. Their demise is both for their masters and for our own sick pleasure. They are managed like animals in a cage, prodded and pushed against their dwindling will. The oppressive atmosphere of the wretched encampment works against the poor husks, drained of their life, ambition, and joy, left only to work until their untimely deaths. No matter their efforts or numbers, their superiors are indifferent to the lives of those who build the foundation of their kingdom. 10 or 10,000 could perish, and none would bat an eye. The machines producing and disposing the empty shells provides enough evidence to suggest that every last worker is expendable. At the slightest glimmer of hope in the repugnant compound, it deteriorates, and the squalid lifestyle continues without change being feasible. Orders are made over an amalgamation of technology through an incoherent babbling. The husks gather to mindlessly listen, knowing that light will never pierce the miles of terrain above them and show them a life they could never have. They're trapped with a clear understanding of their predicament. They will die as they live, and those who are capable of saving at least one tortured soul show little interest. Despite the appearance of regret and pity on those capable, there is nothing left to do when there is nothing done in the first place. Turn a blind eye, wretch. The many fall under the thumb of the few. Descending further into the bowels of this beast, darkness broken by a singular light, though some might consider the symbolic nature of that description to be fruitful in its end. That simply is not the case in this uncaring realm. So what is the aesthetic that Mad God attempts, and succeeds, to epitomize? The grime and filth that decorates this hostile and unforgiving world makes this land feel as though its caretakers have long since abandoned it, leaving it in grotesque disrepair. Or perhaps it has always been like this, and those in their towers have been enjoying the display of futility. The decay suggests that there was something before the wound began festering. War-torn terrain marks a potential past genocide of unprecedented scale. Alternatively, a culling of the population that began under the iron fist of a tyrannical rule. Regardless of the cause, destruction and despair is undeniable. In the film, there are no words spoken in plain English, leaving much to visual interpretation. Although it may appear to some that writing was not involved, that is anything but true. A plot does not exist here. Instead, a narrative which leads us through the twisting labyrinth takes its place entirely. Characters do not drive this story. They are merely along for the ride, as the world around, ahead, and behind them continues to function with or without their influence. The assassin is not here to impact or change what is already in motion. His task is, in some ways, as futile as that of the husks he observed earlier in his journey. Disgust and revulsion may be seen as the aesthetic by some, while the constant display of futility may encourage alternative perspectives. In truth, the film is a masterclass in ambiguity and mysticism. The information is not spoon-fed to a viewer. They are allowed to make their own interpretations and opinions based on the visual storytelling present. The patron is not treated as a less than average and unrefined individual. There is respect shown through the inclusion of such concepts and avoidance of typical and often overplayed film tropes. As confusing as Mad God can be at times, Phil Tippett and his crew of valued volunteers have produced one of the most thought-provoking and intriguing pieces of guided artwork in the past decade. I highly encourage those who have shown even the most remote of interest in this piece to consider viewing it by any means. Personally, I recommend going to Shudder, picking up a free trial, and viewing it in the highest possible quality online. There is much left for interpretation, as I've refrained from including most of the breathtaking and creative scenes. If the events on screen are not thought-provoking, they are at the very least unique in their creativity. While the credits roll, I'd like to apologize about the delay. On top of being sick for the past week, a heat wave, and an unexpected visit from a tornado, it's been difficult getting this essay right. It almost followed the same path as the Iron Lung essay, where the ending was pretty underwhelming. So, again, apologies. Good things are coming, I can promise that. Bear with me, and of course, on behalf of the study, thank you, and have a pleasant day.